Number 1.
When I was little, there was a series of child abductions around my hometown. Or anyway, that's what the local news and papers called it. Truth is, I was from a small county where there wasn't much news to report. What would probably be an average amount of kids disappearing or running away became a headlining story of a killing spree across the countryside. Not to say it wasn't frightening. It was shocking when those kids went missing. First was a young boy a couple of towns over. He was about 2 or 3 years old. It wasn't even publicized until the next 2 kids went missing in the following months. Another little boy in my own neighborhood, around my age, and a little girl was taken from a large acre property off the highway. Once the baby girl disappeared, there was a huge panic in the surrounding towns. They said on the news that the abductions were suspected to be related. They set an early curfew on minors and organized search parties, but they never found anything. I wasn't really afraid. Maybe it was because I didn't understand what the disappearances implied. But I asked my mom about it one night. She was a young single parent, and liked to joke around with me a lot, scare the shit out of me really, but I loved her. I came home from school one day with a pamphlet they handed out to all the kids in the district. I had to get my mom to sign it and return it. It was information on the location of the abductions and tips on keeping one's children out of danger. Walk home in groups, don't talk to strangers, the basics. She read it over with me at dinner. I agreed to walk home with the neighbor kids and lock all the doors and windows when I got home, if she was working the night shift that day. She came in my room and tucked me in later that night. She kissed my cheek and turned off the light. "You know, I wonder if it's the witch from the backwoods." She raised an eyebrow at me, peeking back around the doorway. I pulled my legs up from the edge of the bed. "What witch?" My voice cracked. "Never mind. I shouldn't have brought it up." She started to walk back down the hallway. "Mom," I called. She walked back in my room with a sly grin and sat at the edge of my bed. "Did I scare you?" She laughed. "No, I just never heard of the witch from the woods," I pouted. "Oh, I see. Do you want to hear about her?" I nodded and pulled my covers tighter around me. "Well, they say that there's a witch that lives in the woods near the river. She wasn't always a witch. She actually used to be a young, very beautiful girl. She had a boy who was in love with her, and they were even going to get married. But her love had to go make a living in the city before he could buy her a house and a ring. So he went away while she waited in her father's house in the backwoods." "Is the house still there? The police should go check it," I squirmed. My mom then shushed me. The girl waited and waited, and after a while she realized that she had a baby growing inside of her. My mom smiled. She had a baby on the way, so she wrote a letter to the boy to tell him about the good news. She started sewing clothes and blankets and toys for when it came. She was happy. She always wanted a baby of her own. "But why did she turn evil, though?" My mother's face fell blank. She got a letter back from the boy that she loved, but it was not what she expected. The boy she loved had met another girl in the city. He fell in love with her and decided he would stay there and marry her instead.
"What about the baby?"
"He called the girl a liar and said the baby didn't belong to him."
"Well, was it?"
"The baby was his, but the boy was not coming back, plain and simple. And it broke the girl's heart and turned it into a black witch's heart."
"What did she do?"
"She got sick. She was in so much pain and heartache that she couldn't eat or drink. And eventually, she lost her baby."
"That's not even scary. That's only sad. The story isn't over," she whispered, and crept her fingers up my arm.
"She wanted her baby so bad, and it was taken from her. But she had a witch's heart now, and it poisoned her. It urged her to do terrible things. It urged her to go out at night and climb into a town person's window and steal a new baby for herself. She took the baby back to her house by the river. She was so happy she finally had a baby of her own to love, and she could forget about the boy. She could now make use of all the clothes and blankets and toys she made. But there was something she didn't know about having a witch's heart. She didn't know her heart turned black and poisoned her, and the poison was a curse."
My mom looked towards the light coming from the hall. She loved her stolen baby dearly, but something inside of her had changed.
Her heart? I offered.
Her heart. The same way it urged her to steal the new baby, it now urged her to kill that baby. Maybe it was because it truly wasn't hers, or maybe it was because it reminded her of the heartache that took her baby away. But at the same time, she loved that stolen baby. She wanted to take him to the river and drown him.
Did she kill him? Did she kill the baby?
No, she didn't kill the stolen baby. Instead, she went back out into the night and took another child. She took it to the river and drowned it. It broke her heart again to do it, but it eased the curse. And when she went back inside to her stolen boy, she no longer had the urge to drown him anymore. She cried and cried. She was so happy, but she couldn't let anyone find out what she did. She would have to stay at the river house until the boy grew and the town forgot about the missing babies. She only slipped away into town to bring milk for her baby and food for herself. She spent the rest of the time raising the stolen boy and sewing him toys from scraps of the drowned baby's clothes. But one day, she woke up and she looked at her stolen boy and cried again. The curse was back. She thought it had been cured, but she felt it again. Now, even stronger than before. She realized then that curses don't fade. You feed them, and they sleep, until they grow hungry again. My mom turned to me. I had my blanket tied up my throat. She laughed and pulled it a little tighter.
How does it end?
How does it end? My mother repeated. Those babies that just went missing, if the witch is the one that has been stealing them, the story isn't over yet. I glanced out my window, then my closet. There were so many places a witch could be lurking. I asked my mom if I could sleep with her, and she agreed.
Just tonight, though. Tomorrow I have to work late, and you'll have to go to bed before I get back.
I regretted asking about the witch with a groan. One more boy went missing that summer, and then the abduction stopped. Over the years, whenever a kid disappeared, everybody jumped at the opportunity to blame the serial abductor of my childhood. No bodies were ever found. Sometimes the kids would come home, and it turned out they had just ran away. When I was in high school, I learned the truth about what people thought took those kids every few years in the surrounding area. People said it was some maniac taking the kids from their home and breaking their little bodies. I guess I believed it too, after a while. Chester the Molester. Every town had one, and kids went missing all the time, everywhere. To tell you the truth, I never really thought much about it. But the night my mom told me that story, I'll never forget. She had a way with words. She used to scare the hell out of me all the time, and I loved it. It was our thing. Without a dad around, I didn't have the typical male figure to teach me to be fearless and strong. But my mom did it well enough. I think her stories were her own way of teaching me to be brave and to keep my eyes wide, even when I'm terrified. It was her own way of teaching me how to be a man. My mom is dead now. She killed herself. She had developed a drinking problem as I got older. When I left for college, without me there to take care of her, it only got worse. Then one day, a few years after I moved away, I got a call from a lawyer about my inheritance. She left everything to me, which wasn't really much, a dingy old car, a small savings that I spent on the funeral, and a home that belonged to a grandfather I had never met. The funeral was small. A couple I didn't recognize came, and I introduced myself. The man explained that he was an old friend of my mom's from high school. I thanked him for coming, and they left. There was something familiar about him, but I didn't think too hard about it. After all, I had just lost my mother. I decided to take a few more days leave and drive out to my grandpa's old house. Well, my house. It was hard to find, but I eventually came to it. It was a beautiful old cabin that must have been at least 100 years old, and it was totally secluded, down a long private road, right on the water. I thought about bringing the girl I was seeing here for a weekend before the end of the summer. I parked and walked up the dark wood porch. The key resisted the lock at first, Maybe it had rusted over the years, but I managed to fit it and went inside. Old furniture covered in dust, a small stack of vinyl in the corner, next to a turntable. It was a pretty small house overall. A small kitchen, a living room, one bathroom, and two small bedrooms. I scoped out the master bedroom, opening desk drawers and wall cabinets. Nothing really remarkable, just dust. I went to the smaller room and realized it was a girl's room. My mom's? There were books stacked high on the shelves, slippers on the floor, and an old leather jacket in the closet. I smirked. Mom always hinted at a wilder side, before I came along. I realized I hadn't seen her in over a year, and I would never get the chance again. I decided it was a good time to leave. I would come back some other time and clean the place out. Maybe bring somebody along. I turned to look the place over once more, before locking it back up. When I saw another doorknob peeking out from behind a heavy curtain on the wall, I pulled it aside and opened the door. It was a basement. I took my cell phone out and lit the stairs. It was fully cemented and really small. Maybe it was meant to be a pantry or a wine cellar. I got to the bottom and looked around the small space. There was an armchair in the corner, next to an end table, and a bigger piece of furniture under a sheet. I opened the end table and pulled out a stack of papers and mail. There was an envelope addressed to my mother. I thumbed my mother's name before putting the stack back down. I lifted my cell phone to the blanketed thing occupying most of the space down there. I lifted the sheet off and tossed it aside. It was a bassinet. I lifted the small crumpled bundle inside. A small moth-eaten blanket unfolded, spilling out a couple of little stuffed animals. I picked one up and held my light to it. It was a tiny patchwork bear. I looked closer at it. It was made up of tiny pieces of fabric. I set it down and turned around. I looked towards the light coming from the top of the stairs. A crib in the cellar, behind a hidden door. I picked up the letter from the stack of papers on the end table. I reread the address. The same one the lawyer had written down for me. It didn't occur before then, but I knew about this house all along. Backwood Lane. I shine my light back to the bassinet and the little stuffed animals inside. Patchwork toys, sewn from shreds of baby clothes.
Number 2.
This happened between 1986 and 1987. My father bought a farm in the Free State province of South Africa, which the locals called Gampamadi. It's Sotho, a Native American language for the place where the blood flows. The first week or so, everything went without incident. I was about 3 at the time, so this story is partly what I remember and mostly what I've been told. Unearthly knocks. Around the 3rd night or so of the 2nd week, there came a knock at the master bedroom window. My dad opened the curtain to find no one there. Just as he got to bed, the knock came again, but this time from the kitchen at the other end of the house. My dad got up, but again found no one there. As he turned his back on the door, all hell broke loose. The knocking started again, but went in rapid succession from one window to another, covering the whole house. As my dad gathered us all together, it suddenly started hailing stones. It went on like this for the rest of the night, until the first African plovers started their calls in the morning. And then all went silent. Apparently, it did not only torment us as the owners of the farm. The farm workers who were left the next morning didn't want to start work out of fear for the Tokoloshe, similar to Russia's Domovoi. They believed it responsible for the phenomenon. Most workers even left the same day. A glimpse into the past. Things slowly escalated from there as if testing my parents' tolerance. Lots of times I called my mom while playing, bathing, etc., telling her to make the uncle leave, only for her to find no one around. Other spirits also started appearing around the house and garden. I believe that these were former owners and inhabitants of our farm. They appeared to be wearing clothes from the early 1900s. An older gentleman in his 60s haunted the house, smoking a pipe. The smell of pipe smoke would sometimes fill the living room with a young man around his early 20s. On bright, sunny days, we'd see a woman in her 30s cutting roses from the formal garden. A young girl around 5 years old ran around her mother, both of them wearing bonnets, as was the custom among Boer folk for centuries. A few nights later, my family heard the neighing of horses in the old stone corral, a type of cattle or livestock enclosure. There was a sound of hoofs on the ground, the muted voices of men talking or discussing something, and the sound of the heavy iron gates swaying open, followed by a voice calling, "Voorwaarts, men!" It roughly translates from Afrikaans, which is closely related to Dutch, to "charge, men." The horses would then bolt from the open gates, circling the house, accompanied by the sound of horse whips. This usually lasted around 30 minutes every night. The creepy part is that the corral was used by the Boers during the Anglo-Boer War of 1899. There are also some British graves in the middle of one of the cornfields as a reminder of the Boer victory during some unnamed battle in 1900. Dog trouble. Our healthy Boer bulldogs were lying on their backs with their eyes turned back in their sockets, their mouths foaming. At first, my parents thought the animals had been poisoned. My father fetched the pickup, put the dogs on the back, and rushed toward town to take them to a vet. Just as my father exited the gate at the border of the farm, the dogs suddenly got up and acted as if nothing was wrong. This continued countless times with the dogs, immobilized for up to 15 minutes. Brother attacked. Things quickly got worse from this point on. The sound of stones raining on the corrugated roof got worse, and the entity started finding human targets. My father and my 17-year-old brother were on the patio one evening when a stone hit my brother on the forehead. My father and brother both described the sound as a high-pitched whizzing noise, as if the stone had been hurled from a slingshot. The next day, my father installed powerful spotlights around the house and cut all of the lovely fruit trees surrounding the home down in an attempt to catch the culprits. It was all to no avail. Everything continued as usual with no one in sight. It seemed as if the rocks being thrown materialized from thin air. At this stage, the activity started to focus on my brother. He stayed in his own one-bedroom flat about 10 meters from the main house. One night he was studying for a year-end exam when something unseen attacked him from behind. My brother was big and strong and into bodybuilding at that time, but an epic struggle ensued with the creature trying to strangle him for 25 minutes. When my brother finally broke loose from the creature's grip, he was covered in blood and it looked like he'd been strangled with a garrote wire. His chest looked like it had been slashed by claws or blunt metal blades. To this day, in his 40s, he still bears the scars on his chest. The Hellhound. My brother was not the only victim, as it turned out. My mom was lying on the bed one day reading a book when she suddenly became paralyzed. Shortly thereafter, a bulldog appeared at the bedroom door. My mother said it felt like an eternity as she soaked in every detail of the entity. It was also a Boer Bell dog, but he had a white spot between his eyes, whereas ours had black masks. Its face was tinted reddish pink as if by blood, and red slime dripped from its mouth. The dog then started towards her, jumping on the bed, pinning her down, and started staring her into the eyes. After what must have felt like an eternity, the dog jumped off and left the room. This happened a few times more, even at night with my father next to her. Being paralyzed, my mother could not alert my father. An aunt investigates. Being a stout Protestant Christian, my aunt did not believe the account she heard from my mother, so she came to visit with my niece, who was around 15 at the time. My sister and my niece were sitting in the bath when a stone flew through the window and cracked the tub between them. My aunt decided to brave the night and sleep over, but when we woke up the next morning, my aunt and niece were gone. They'd packed their bags in the middle of the night and drove nearly 400 kilometers home. I actually admire her for her bravery as she had to go outside and walk the 20 meters to her car. She said something happened in the spare bedroom shortly after we switched off the lights, but she refused to tell us what happened to this very day. Things get worse. Although the activity usually started around dusk and continued until the first American plovers called in the early morning hours, activity started to happen during daylight hours as well. There would be whispering around the house as two dark shadows moved around. These same two dark shadows also circled the house every night. We believed that they were the cause for poltergeist-like activity. It is actually reported by the natives that Tokoloshis usually work in pairs. At this point, the only time the activity ceased was when the police or people who did not have a close bond to the family visited. It immediately resumed after they left. Around this time, spontaneous fires started around the employees' homes. It started out almost harmless, but one day one of the employees came bashing at the door screaming that one of their workers' house was burning down and that the flames were leaping from the windows. The worker was on leave and the door was locked from the outside with a strong deadbolt. When they finally opened the door, witnesses saw that only the edges of the kitchen cupboards were burning. After the flames were extinguished and all the smoke subsided, they were shocked to find that there was no damage apart from the burst windows and smoke damage. The witch doctor arrives. My parents now got desperate as my father had put all their savings into a deposit for the farm. Selling it then would have financially ruined them. The church did not seem to care and even alleged that my parents did this for attention. My parents used to be respected people in this town as my father was head of the traffic department and a deacon in the church. Suddenly people laughed behind their backs and most in town had abandoned my family at this stage. Some even accused my brother of staging it all. My dad now was being fed up with nothing working and contacted a traditional witch doctor from the old Bofotswana. When the witch doctor came, he asked for a glass of water, looked into it, and told my father things of a very personal nature, things very few people know, certainly no one in the town knew. The witch doctor started to perform a cleansing ritual before he removed a few boxes filled with stuff like fingernail clippings, hair, etc. He then went on to tell my dad that the previous owner had put a curse on the farm as he was pissed off because he went bankrupt and wanted no one else to stay for long. The night after the cleansing, a storm came up, but instead of thunder, there was the crying of a baby. Very freaky. The wind blew from one border fence of the farm to the other, about 1,500 hectares, and then almost everything stopped as suddenly as it had started. Most people don't believe my story, but trust me. Sometimes the truth really is stranger than fiction. Hello everyone, my name is Mr. Davis. I would love if you checked out my channel to hear more. Right now I'm nearing 8,000 subscribers, and it would be great if you guys could come over there and help me reach that goal. And a big thanks to Unit 522 for having me on once again. He's a great guy and a great friend. With that said, stay safe. And stay creepy.
There's always a reason to be afraid.